The meeting to order for Monday, April 20th. As always, we need to approve the agenda. It looks like that we may have to add a couple of little things to the agenda.
Can I add something to the agenda?
Hang on a second. We got a certificate of compliance for town road and bridge standards in network inventory. That's from the Public Works Director, so we'll add that to the agenda. Is that it, Bill? Okay. Is there anything else from any of you guys?
Yes. We had a brief discussion on the school board's selection of the Waterbury school member.
You can. Yep.
Just very brief. It shouldn't take more than a few minutes.
Somebody else there?
That's Mark. It denied me the first time I tried calling in.
Mark, just started.
Yeah, so we just finished out the, haven't approved the agenda yet, just added a few things to it. Do you have anything you'd like to talk about, Mark?
Nope.
Okay. So with those necessary changes, would somebody like to approve the agenda as presented?
I make a motion to approve the agenda as amended.
Second, please.
Second.
Okay. All those who wish to approve, please say aye.
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 Consent agenda items are simply the minutes from April 6th meeting and extend a waiver for late fee for dog licenses until May 31st, 2020. Would there be a motion to approve the consent agenda, please?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 Doesn't appear there's any public unless we've missed somebody that's jumped on the phone since we started. Doesn't appear so. So we'll let Bill take the helm and jump right into manager's item.
Okay, good evening, everyone. The first item of business is economic development services. I sent you a letter by email yesterday. It was a draft letter that I proposed to send to Karen Nevin at RW. I thought Karen and Melissa both were going to be on the call tonight. I know I sent Karen this agenda, so hopefully they're not trying to call the other phone line, but I think whether they are here or not, my recommendation is that you approve the sending of that letter. The long and short of it is that, as I indicated in the letter, I had a conversation with Karen last week, and you know, some of their revenue sources are down, as you might expect. Businesses, even though that they've had some new members join RW as a result of this crisis, their memberships are down, their individual contributions are down, and they expect that they will have other reductions in their budget. They've already taken steps to cancel the Arts Fest that is normally held in July, I think it is. They've applied for some of the federal programs that are available to not-for-profit organizations like they are. And they've simply want a letter from us allowing them to kind of use the $70,000 that we supply them so that they can continue to provide their full portfolio of services. So if they don't use some of the money directly for economic services per se, that they would be using all of their money that we have I think that they are invaluable organization right now. They are providing lots of assistance. I just walked in, so.
Your line is full, just so you know.
Yeah.
Question.
There's only like five, four people on it.
Because this user has reached
your
full limit for conference
calls. Do you have the right agenda?
I will call it.
That's the same thing message I got when I tried calling.
I'll try it again right now, but that's so I helped in my car because I'm going to get those downtown.
Anyway, people are evidently having problems with getting in through the phone line. But that's all I have to say, Chris. My recommendation is that you want to drive on the next time the letter.
Anybody got any questions or comments at this point?
I mean, I'm in support of the letter as all of us are facing times when you know our income might be suffering. We're having to pick and choose where we're spending our money, and I think that this gives them the ultimate flexibility. So I would I'd be in support of it.
I echo that.
What's that?
I echo that sentiment that Nat has. I thought it was a good letter by Bill, and I think revitalizing Waterbury is going to be a very important cog to, you know, our recovery from this whole thing like they were after Irene. So I think it would be foolish to cut that money.
This is Mark.
I'm going to ask Bill this question. He may not be able to answer it any more than probably anybody can at this time. But do you have any sense of certification on Main Street construction project as to whether that
No, I mean the governor's revision of his amendment allows. You know, two people to work together. I don't think that's been close to being able to start construction going again. But we haven't heard anything beyond what we heard last week. And, you know, this letter really doesn't have anything to do with construction services, a portion of what they have with the funded piece for their organization. So all this letter is suggesting is that we're going to continue to send them the $70,165 that was budgeted, and we're going to let them just use it where they need to use it post, as opposed to specifically indicate that they've got to use it for this or that. The letter that I sent out yesterday said $75,160, but I double counted $5,000. So I've changed. I didn't send out the letter again today, but I have changed it. It's $70,160.
So would somebody like to make a motion to approve the letter of funding confirmation to Revitalizing Waterbury as presented?
I would make that motion.
Do we even need a motion? Because we have already approved that money, and this is just a, you know, just a recertification that we're going to do what we said we're going to do.
Yeah, but Mike, the letter specifically tells them that they can use our money for anything that they want.
Okay.
That's important for them to have as they deal with the people who make the federal rules about PPP. Program and all the rest of it. But yes, we need a motion to authorize me to sign the letter.
Point taken.
So Nat made the motion, and you
I'll
just
second.
Said you changed the 5,000. You took the 5,000 off it, so this 75,160 is now 71,160. Okay. All right. Who seconded that?
This is Mark. I'll second it.
Okay. All right. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those who wish to approve it, please say aye.
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 Motion passes.
Thank you. I did put time to dial again and the treasurer into that.
Whoever's speaking, we can't hear you.
Yeah, no, it's Alyssa there. She's kind of sitting in the back of the room, and she was just talking about the troubles she was having dialing in. So.
Okay. All right.
We're gonna look into that, but that's all that was.
Well, then, hello, Alyssa.
I got right in.
Like I said, the same thing happened to me when I tried calling.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway.
Luck of the draw. Okay. We can move forward with the update on the lending concept for sick time.
Yeah, we spoke about this at the last meeting. The board was predisposed to do it. I mentioned at the time because I wanted to present it to the EFLUD board. The EFLUD board did authorize it as was presented. I would ask you to do the same thing just for the sake of consistency. I hope we don't have to go through the whole process again that we talked about last week. I'd like you to approve it in case we decide to implement it. Right now, however, it's looking like it probably will not be implemented, but I'd still like the approval since you were predisposed to do it at your last meeting and the EFLUD commissioners did it. That way, if something happens down the pike and we do have to implement it, I won't have to come back to the board.
Anybody got any questions on that or comments?
Yeah, question. This is Katie. If you do have to use that in the future, will you notify us ahead of time?
Oh, yeah, I will. Okay. If we implement it, probably it would be slightly changed. One of the issues that we grappled with a little bit that night, and then as I looked at it when I talked to my presenter to the people folks, is that the concept that I had of kind of letting people sell or donate their sick time and then kind of redistributing that to everyone, if we do it, we'll probably just make it available into a universal bank as opposed to redistribute the sick time to individual people. It worked out okay on the town side of things, but because there's only 5 employees at EFUB, and because the wages are a little bit higher, things got skewed out a little bit. And if you looked at one EFUD employee was hired about the same time as one particular town employee, and you'd like to see that they would both end up with similar amounts of sick time if we put that redistribution plan into place. The EFUD employee got way more sick time than the town employee had available to him, and it doesn't make sense that way. So if we implement it, it will be done in the same fashion as I explained, except all of the donated time will just go into a universal bank, and then employees can draw down on that if they need it. No one will get a permanent increase to their sick pay. I think it will work better, but I'm also thinking we don't have to do it at all. But I would like it for people to do it in case you have to. And that's Katie, I will let you know if we put it in place.
Any other questions? Okay, hearing none. One of you would love to make a motion to approve the lending concept for sick time through a donation or sale formula for town employees if needed. I'd like to make that motion. Hello? You guys hear me?
Yeah, I'll make the motion to approve the lending program for sick leave for town employees as presented by the town manager.
Here, second.
Did someone second it? I'll second it. Okay.
Who seconded it?
I'll do it. All right. Is there any further questions or comments? All right. Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Okay, that's done, and we'll move on to the next item, COVID-19 update.
Yeah, so this is, I actually did this mostly in an email that I sent Friday out Friday afternoon. It was, I sent the update and put the agenda together, but things are going along about as they have in the, when we reported at the last meeting. The big takeaway right now is that there have been more reductions in the workforce, both in terms of some people being partially laid off and others being fully laid off now. So in the municipal office, we have two 40-hour employees that have been completely laid off. We have one 20-hour employee that has been completely laid off. We have a 40-hour employee who is still working, who is probably submitting an unemployment claim because she's getting about somewhere between 18 and 20 hours. In the library, we have two part-time people that have been fully laid off. A number of other staff there have had their hours reduced a little bit. Salary staff now all have volunteered to have a reduction in their pay from all departments. I met with the library commissioners on Thursday last week. They had a meeting on Thursday. I reviewed a budget with them that's very similar to the one that I sent out to you for the library yesterday, except they understood what I had to say, and they are the process of implementing some additional staffing cuts in the library. As far as full layoffs are concerned, I have added four highway employees to the fully laid off list. So 3 weeks ago, I cut all eight highway employees to 20 hours a week. We had a work schedule that was a seven-day week schedule to make sure that we had everything covered in case there was a storm, regardless of what day it came. Starting today, the highway staff has been reduced to four crew persons, and they are all still working 20 hours a week. So we're down to 80 hours a week of work in the highway department. There was a directive that went out from the Agency of Commerce last week that I included in the email that I sent you that really spells out how restrictive the governor's order is with regard to these types of crews. So for that reason, and probably more so for what I feel is the need to try to reduce expenses, the highway crew had that layoff of four people completely. They are working, the four people that are working are pretty typically working on gravel roads. There's grading that's going on. I don't know as if they've had to haul any real material of any consequence around this time yet, but they're working on the back roads. They're taking care of potholes. And they're doing work in the garage and on equipment. we will have to think about what's going to happen with all of the playing fields and cemeteries and parks within a couple weeks here. My direction so far to Celia with regard to lawn mowing and any kind of groundskeeping is to do what's minimal to keep the turf manageable. In other words, I don't want it to grow up to hay, but we will not be manicuring it for play. The baseball leagues and the other sports leagues are on temporary hiatus right now anyway. They can't go back until after May 15th at the earliest. We're waiting to hear about how the governor feels about that, allowing, you know, groups, significant groups of people to get together and play sports. So for the time being, we're going to just try to take care of the grass to keep it in a condition that doesn't let it get out of hand. I haven't talked to Celia about roadside mowing, but my expectation and my desire would be that if the layoffs are still in place as they are now, when it comes time to have to try to mow down those invasive species, I think we'll do that unless we're specifically told that we can't. I don't see how having one person out on the tractor all by himself could spread the disease at all. So my expectation is that we will do that when the time comes. I have told all of the employees so far that have been laid off or who have hours reduced that there's two bars that we have to pass, two mile markers that we have to pass before people are called back, certainly on a large scale basis. The first bar, of course, is the social distancing bar. If on May 15th or thereabouts the governor says everybody can go back to work, well, that's one bar, and people can be allowed to come to work and do what they need to do. But the other bar for us is where we stand financially, and that will be much more difficult to get a handle on because we're not going to have any real evidence of reduced revenues in the municipality until we get into July at the earliest. So I have told them all that they should anticipate being out until July 1st possibly, and frankly, you know, I think it could go longer than that for some, depending upon what we feel we want to do with regard to the budget. We'll talk about the budget in a few minutes. You know, I just wanted to pass that information along that it's not just the governor's order that we're awaiting. That's the first thing that has to happen. But can we just go back to like nothing happened immediately? I'm not sure that we can. So with that, I'll stop and you can ask questions if you have any.
Bill, couple of questions. One, how has the most recent governor's announcement that, you know, people of one or two, you know, people in construction as well as professional people, you know, may be able to go back to work? Have you gotten any of the staff, you know, talking about that? You know, are they subject to that?
Well, you know, we already have people that are working here from time to time. So Carla comes in the office three days a week for several hours at a time. Karen Petrovich, the utility building clerk, tax clerk, she's coming into the office about 3 days a week or so, usually from about 2 o'clock until 5, maybe 6 in the afternoon. So she's putting in maybe 10 to 12 hours of time here at the office, and the rest of her time, which is about 20-ish hours altogether, from home. Carla does some of her work from home. Steve is doing his work for the most part, you have to come in a few hours a week to get ready for meetings in particular. Bill Woodruff and I are pretty typically in the office every day. Bill comes early and is usually gone by 3 or so. I usually get here sometime between 9 and 10, and most days I'm here until after 5. But we are not open to the public, so when the governor's discussion came down last week that clerks might be able to be open, law firms, appraisers, you know, single person employment, if you will, businesses that
right.
employ employees. That's really telling them that they can go to work. It doesn't mean that we are allowing them into our office. There's nothing that a paralegal needs to do a title search that Carla already isn't able to get to them. So we're not opening our office at this point. As far as the outside work, we already have small crews of highway employees. They have been working crews of no more than 2, even when they were all 8 working. Now there's only 4 of them. Pretty typically, you know, they're working alone or in a small group, and they're trying to practice social distancing. We had some requests today from King Su Bar that, like, you know, the garden club would like to get going on some of the gardening work and the like. We said no to that for right now. We've told the landscape people that we actually pay, that we don't want them coming here to do anything for us until May 15th. So we're going to even tell that to the volunteers right now, that we'd rather that we just leave it as it is for the moment. So we're awaiting the situation as it unfolds, Mike. And again, for our employees, the layoffs, for the most part, have been instituted for 2 reasons. One, there's a few of them that really don't have the ability to work from home or don't need to work from home. So Pam Pratt, for instance, she's mainly receptionist, secretary, does some clerical work. There's nothing that she asked to do from home that can't be done by somebody else either here or home. So she's not working at all. Same with Beth Jones, the assistant town clerk. Dina has been laid off, and we're having Steve do that work. So the fact that we've laid them off is more a function of trying to save money than it is, keeping them isolated, so to speak. And from my perspective, at this point, that the financial side of the equation is much more driving my decisions right now than the social distancing is. I mean, we need to be smart and safe, and we want to comply with the order. But the decisions I've made mainly have to do with how it impacts the town's budget.
Thanks, Bill. The second part of my question is a little different. I know Steve's kind of taking up Dina's work. Is, like, for instance, are we having many permits? Is the DRB meeting, or are other boards meeting at all at this time, even if they're meeting remotely?
Yeah, the only board that I'm aware of that isn't meeting at all right now is the Cemetery Commissioners. The DRB has been pretty active. I think they have had all their meetings. They have a number of reviews that were scheduled to have a meeting last week. They've got another one in a week or so. And they have fairly extensive agendas for projects that were already in the pipeline, Mike.
Right. That's what I figured so much.
I don't know. Is the Planning Commission meeting?
They canceled their last meeting.
The Planning Commission.
They canceled the meeting. I know the Planning Commission did.
The Planning Commission, I believe, has only met once or twice since the shutdown, and they canceled their last meeting. So there's not a lot of planning that's going on right now.
Right. I figured the DRB still has stuff to do, you know, because there are projects, in the pipeline.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks for the update, Bill.
Yeah, I'll just say one thing here before we move on. Probably as you've witnessed, you've seen a lot of people start to get a little restless about the stay-home order. Obviously, for the state of Vermont, we have seemed to have had a much easier time with this problem than some of these other states with big cities and whatnot. I've even had some friends, you know, agree with this protesting. Other states are perhaps, I think their guidelines may be a little bit stricter. And people are starting to protest because they want things to go back to normal. I had a friend of mine there that was kind of agreeing with that type of mentality there today, and I simply said to him that, you know what, it's okay if those people want to take the risk and go back to what they consider normal with probably a higher percentage of contracting the disease if they do that. But if I were the governor of those states, I would say, you're taking this chance at your own risk. And if you get infected, don't bother to show up at the hospital, because you're not going to take and be foolish about, you know, jumping beyond these guidelines, getting yourself infected, and then going to the hospital and expect people up there to put themselves at risk to save your butt because you decided to do the wrong thing. Nobody on any reporting media outlet has, or anybody in the political world, has even bothered to have the guts to stand up and say that. You know, it's one thing if you want to put yourself at risk, but don't expect some caregiver to put their life online to help save you after you decided to be stupid.
It's even worse than that, because they're putting you at risk, too.
So anyway, I think it's smart that we continue to follow the guidelines as best possible. I hope the government doesn't jump too soon. I know they're starting to get daggers thrown at them, so because they're not, you know, some people suggesting that they're moving too fast, other people suggesting they're not moving fast enough. So I wouldn't want to be in the governor's shoes for anything. So,
agreed.
Having said that, if there's no other comments or questions, we can move on to the budget report.
Okay. So I sent you yesterday afternoon or evening. It was later than I hoped, but I've been working at this. It feels like January again. I'm working every day on budgets right now. And, I thought I was kind of here. I think the best thing to do first is look at the CIP budget. So that would be the one that is the first page is the paving fund, Fund 70. And what I'm trying to do here with both of these budgets, kind of working with them simultaneously, is to ultimately see where we get as far as surplus or deficit is concerned, if we take certain action. And as I said in my email yesterday, I'm not asking you to approve a budget now. We have a budget that was approved at town meeting. That will remain our budget in terms of what shows up every month when budget reports are done. But I'm going to try to target lower spending, certainly, and I'm trying to estimate revenues. So if we look at the CIP budget first, the first one is the paving fund, and there's no science behind this. It's a little bit of art, a little bit of kind of my philosophy about things, and a little bit of math. So in the paving fund, I'm not proposing any cut to the transfer from the highway fund. So the $447,655 that's scheduled to come out of the highway fund to go into the paving fund, I'm going to recommend that we make that transfer. The pilot funds, there's a little bit of a question about how much of the pilot money are we going to get. Between the general fund and the fund 70, we anticipated about $308,000. And that was pushing the envelope a little bit in the first place anyway. And now I really don't know what's going to happen. The pilot payments don't get made until October. Typically, we get a letter in May that tells us what our pilot payment is going to be. It's generally based on a lot of information from the prior year, so 2019. So if they do it, as they always have, we might not have any reduction in pilot. But if they prospectively say we're going to be in a world of hurt next year as far as the local option tax that funds this, they may decide that they need to cut now. If they cut, I'm proposing all of the cut come out of the general fund. So here in the paving fund, I've left the $100,000 coming from the pilot saying that we'll put that $100,000 in here. We had $500,000 of paving budgeted mainly to do Maple Street. We said that if we had enough money, we might also do Howard Avenue. I talked to Bill Woodruff about a month ago and said, Howard Avenue is bad, but we should look at, you know, around the post office on Guffel Road up through Maple Street. That might be a better place to get. Certainly has a lot more traffic than Howard Ave does. But in any event, I'm just suggesting that maybe we'll spend $475,000. The estimate to do Maple Street was in the 460 to 480 range. If prices come down at all, maybe we can do it all and only spend 475. But my proposal is that we will still pay Maple Street in 2020. So that's the paving fund. Fund 71 is the infrastructure fund. Starting at the expenditures, the only thing that I've changed here is I have taken the $170,000 for the bridge improvement. That would be the bridge on Guffel Road that's closest to Dr. Murray's house. And that we would just push that off for a year. It needs to be done, but it's not a safety issue right now. It's deferring something for a year. The Main Street project, we have to pay whatever the state bills us based on how much work gets done. The 160 was a little bit lower than the cost would have been if they actually did everything that they had hoped to do in Main Street this year. So since they're going to start late, if they start at all, they'll do less. But I think we need to leave the 160 there just because it's the number that based on somebody else's decision making. For now, I'm leaving the sidewalk repair and replacement. This would be a stretch of sidewalk on Winooski Street, which would be on the east side of Winooski Street, the same side that Hender's bakery is on. And the intention was that this sidewalk replacement on Winooski Street would match in with the sidewalk that was supposed to be done on Main Street as part of the Main Street project. So for now, that's left in there. I told Bill Woodruff this morning, we typically don't do the sidewalks until late summer or into the fall. We have plenty of time to reevaluate if we think we need to take this out.
You do that with... You've been doing it with your own, the town's crew. Would you still consider that?
Yeah, that's what the $38,000 based on the town crew. And then the building improvements, I'm leaving the $46,000 in there. We've already spent $8,400. That was to buy the new lift for the highway department. That was installed in January. And then the remainder of the money is to repair the roof. The roof needs to be repaired. I think it would be a mistake not to do that. So I've left that money there. going back up to the top of the page, what I've done here, though, by taking out that $170,000, I've reduced the amount of loan proceeds that we were going to use to support that budget, and I've reduced the transfer from the highway fund. What I did there, the number that says 0.47, so 47%, the 194,750 for loans was 47% of everything in the expenditures except for the debt service down below. So when I took out the 170, I still used the same percentage, so 47% of 160 plus 38 plus 46, which comes up to 244, which is down there on the right in the middle of the page. 47% of that is 114,780. So that's where that loan proceeds number came up with. And then what I tried to do in the end was have these funds end up close to where they would have been had we done everything in them. This one has actually a higher fund balance than it would have had. So I've reduced $39,570 from a transfer from the highway department, which in effect will be able to reduce the highway fund. The highway vehicle fund, same thing, exact same kind of math. We've already bought the roadside mower, and we've already ordered the tandem dump truck. We ordered that in January and told the manufacturer that we'd agreed to the order so that we would have it before the winter of 20 and 21. And if they had told us that they would let us out of the contract if the town said no to the project, which is that town meeting. The town didn't say no, so we're gonna have to buy that truck. The one-ton truck, $87,000 for the one-ton truck. We'll not buy that this year. That's something that we'll defer, whether it's a one-year deferment or go beyond that. We're going to have to re-scramble or re-evaluate all of those CLCs forward. But that $87,000 comes out. That allows us to reduce borrowing in that fund from $205,190 to $154,460 and reduce the transfer from the highway department by $36,270. So we transfer $150,125. Let me get through all of this, and then you can ask questions toward the end. In the fire department, Fund 73, we have a fire truck that's on order that should be delivered sometime in July time. That's the spending of $489,645. But when I looked at the fund balance for Fund 73 at the end of the year, I propose that we do all the borrowing that we had anticipated, 902,500, which is less than was authorized. We were authorized to borrow 950, but I'm borrowing all that money, or proposing that we borrow all that money. That would be a good cash infusion into the town when we might be needing cash. I've already talked about the rationale for paying for that over the 20-year life of the fire truck. So the 902,500 would be the financing for both fire trucks, the one we bought in the fall at the November meeting and the one we're going to pay for in June. But what I did here is, since the borrowing is staying the same and that fund balance is pretty hefty, it's over $500,000 was the end of the year fund balance for the fire fund, I decided that I would reduce the entire $172,000 that's going to be transferred to this fund from the fire budget. So that's a significant reduction, of course. And then the Fund 75, I've reduced the transfer from the rec department by $11,000. It will leave the fund with $874 in it as opposed to $15,000. I do propose to do all the work in that fund. We had, bottom of the page, on that page. So $11,000 is for the roof at the pool. That roof probably should have been changed probably 3 or 4 years ago. It's really in pretty bad shape. I think we should still spend the $11,000 to do the roof. The community gardens, we're moving forward with that. $11,000, we have revenue that comes in to offset that, a lot of that. I do propose that we put off the work at the Armory Park. This is the armory that's up behind the school on that hillside that the Rotary Club puts the Christmas tree strings up on. There's a small area there that is used as there's some trails there that the school uses. We had intended to go in there and do some a little bit of logging to take out some overgrowth that needs to be removed, and then some work was going to be done to try to protect the pathways. So I pulled that $5,000 out. Now, with all of the changes that I've proposed here, between justice spending, between reductions in transfers, and reductions in borrowing, you'll notice on that last page that the fund balance for the CIP funds, if all of this works out exactly as on these pages, will be $220,504, which is $52,000 less than we had anticipated in the budget. We've always used all of these funds kind of in concert, so some of the funds have big fund balances, like the fire equipment fund does, and some of them have big deficits, sort of like the paving has a modest deficit. The highway vehicle fund has a modest deficit. The fire fund has a big surplus. So I looked at this and I said, okay, we can reduce the transfers into the CIP from the operating funds by 76, about $240,000, and still end up with a reasonable fund balance. When we get through talking about the town's operating budgets in a minute, if you want more reductions in taxes this year, or if you want to reduce, or if you want to save more on transferring to the CIP funds, you could do that because, you know, we could target to end the year with nothing in the CIP fund. So there's an additional $220,000 that's available there. I don't think that's a very good idea. We don't have to decide now. But with that, I'm going to stop talking and see if you have any questions. If you don't have any questions about the CIP funds and the proposed cuts in spending and transfers there, we can move over to the operating budgets. And this is a little bit more complicated. We're going to make it pretty brief. I'm not going to go on ad infinitum here, ad infinitum, but I think that you'll understand what I'm doing. So let's start with the highway and the library funds first. And the reason I want to start with those two funds first is because accounting principles kind of mandate that those funds are going to show the taxes that they're supposed to get. So we voted at town meeting to raise $4,199,000 of taxes, and of that, $1,882,000 was for highways, $484,430 was for library, and then the balance, $1,000,000, 182 for the general fund. So since the highway fund and the library fund from a financial statement point of view are going to get all of their taxes posted to their account, we'll start with these two funds. So in the highway department, you can see at the top of the page under revenues, the budget was $1,882,690 for taxes. In the projected column, the new target column right in the middle, that number shows up again. I have reduced the Vermont State Aid from 113 to 107,365. Again, I don't have any information that tells me this is going down. The state has a July 1st fiscal year. So the payment that we have received so far, $56,629, if you divide that by two, we got the first payment of we got the first payment of about $28,315 from the state in January. We got the second payment of that same $28,314 in April. The next payment is due in July, and then the final payment is due in October. I'm just speculating that the state's going to cut this a little bit, so I used a lower number. Everything else there pretty much is the same. The highway labor materials, $16,000 to $10,000. That really doesn't mean much because that's a transfer from that revenue comes from a different town department, so it really doesn't matter. It's whatever the expense is in the other fund will be the income there, so don't worry about that too much. But everything else is as it was. So revenues just dropped slightly in this projection for the highway department for this year by about $12,000 from $1,022,000 to $2,010,000. So that's about $12,000. In the expenditure side, now here's where, you know, I'm kind of walking out on the limb a little bit because I don't know all of these things that will come to pass. The pay line reflects the fact of the reduction in staff and then the reduction, the actual layoffs. This takes us through July 1st, so through June. If it has to be extended, obviously that 342 will go down. And it's not hard and fast number because when we get to the end of the year, we start doing snow and overtime again. Health insurance doesn't change. We have told all the employees so far that we'll keep benefits in place. So while they're laid off, we're still paying their health insurance. Disability is the same thing. Social Security, that's a little bit down, and it reflects the reduction in the regular pay line, as does retirement. That's down by a couple $1,000. Unemployment is fixed. That's annual. We pay that quarterly, and it's based on a bill that we get in January. So that's not going to change. The workers' compensation, you can see that's actually higher than it was budgeted. The reason it's higher is because our insurance company audits us every year for workers' compensation, and it's based on payroll, so we had a higher payroll last year. I don't know if this 54,260 is the right number yet. I just know that we are going to owe a balance for last year, and it will increase that line item. So that's why that's up a little bit. Clothing and safety wear, small decrease there. Grounds maintenance down in the middle of the page. And I haven't done this. I haven't reviewed this with Celia or Bill Woodruff yet. But I just said, well, we're going to cut our grounds maintenance. That's basically at the highway garage by $3,000. Maybe we can cut more, but I cut it in half. I cut the building maintenance a little bit just because they're not there as much right now. There's no science for that number. There's no other changes really until you get down to equipment maintenance. I didn't highlight that, but $33,000 budget. I've knocked about $5,000 off of that, just because they're not using the equipment to the degree that they normally would, namely vehicle maintenance. Those two lines conceivably could have more savings, but I don't want to project too much savings now. We can adjust this as we go forward. Gas and diesel fuel, that's down simply because of price, and I could probably knock it down a little bit more because of usage, frankly. I don't think the reduction that I show there is mainly accounted for price decreases. So those numbers could probably be a little bit lower. Public Works Director is a fixed cost. Tree maintenance, I was going to cut that, but we had a huge tree up on High Street, that is in pretty tough shape. It may have already been taken down, but I think we're going to probably spend that line out. And then I've cut the contractors by about $5,000, cut summer maintenance a little bit. Bridges and culverts, I left those as they are because if we have bad culverts or undersized culverts, it behooves us to get them fixed and changed if we can. I left the fluoride out at the same amount. And I left salt and sand at the same amount for now. I'm tempted to cut those, but I didn't cut it for the time being. I did cut the gravel of $9,000, it looks like. And then I'm the same thing. Down toward the bottom, it's pretty much the same. I cut the equipment in half. And then at the very bottom, you can see the difference. I guess I didn't do the math there, but the difference between the 849, 745, and the 793, 905, that is the reduction of the transfers for to the CIP from the highway department. So about $75,000 reduction there, I think it is. So if this all comes to pass, if this happens, we would end up with $151,000 surplus in the highway fund because it's going to get all of its revenue, virtually all of its revenue, and we're going to cut spending. So that reduction in spending from 1,988 to 1,826, that reduction shows up, and we end up with at the end of the day, we end up with $151,000 fund balance in the highway fund. I'll pause there for a second, see if you have any questions. And before you ask the question, particular line items are important, but my goal was really looking at bottom lines. So if you think that there's a line item that we could get more savings out of, that's great. If it's sand and salt, it might be a real savings. Otherwise, it's just a target. But anyway, 151 surplus in the highway fund. I'll stop if you have questions.
I don't have a question. This is Mark. But if anyone's not talking, can you mute your mics? I don't know if anyone else is getting a bunch of feedback on their end, but I'm having trouble hearing.
I second that, Mike. I think, Bill, you've done a great job making some adjustments, and I really don't have any substantial questions.
Okay, well, if we move on to the library fund then, this will be quick. As I said, I met with the library commissioners on Thursday last week. They have not made any real substantial cuts in staffing. All of their people are working from home, and all of them have been putting their full time in, except the two part-time people who I told you were laid off. And I asked a few questions about that. I know from just observing the people who are working on this side of the building that it's pretty hard to expect or to understand how they're putting in a full work week when they're not here and they don't have customers to specifically deal with, but that's what has been happening. After the meeting, I left. They obviously made some decisions. What I told them was, what I'm going to tell you in a minute, it's why we started looking at the highway fund and the library fund first. Because those two funds on paper get all their revenue, and then they're going to cut their budget, they're going to end up with a surplus. And we don't have to go through this one, quite the fine-tooth comb that we went through the highway budget. But you can see their revenue right now looks like it's going to drop by about $1,000, $1,200. And their expenses are going to drop by 24,000, I think it is. So the library fund, they had only picked around some of the savings that could come from, like, a reduction in the book budget and a little bit of reduction in the equipment and things like that. They really hadn't done anything as far as payroll was concerned. When I explained to them, I said, you're going to end up the year probably with a surplus, bigger than you had anticipated at the beginning of the year. They were supposed to break even. I said, you're going to get almost all your revenue, and you're going to make cuts in your spending, so you're going to end up the year with a surplus. But don't be fooled, because if you end up the year with a surplus, and the general fund ends up with a huge deficit, that's going to have to be made up to all departments. So they did take some action. And all the library director communicated and came over the weekend. But for now, this is their target budget. They're hoping to reduce their spending by, like I said, about $22,000 to $24,000, whatever it is. And their revenues will be about the same. So their target right now, if all this comes to pass, would be a $24,000 surplus in that department. So between the library surplus at the end of the year and the highway surplus, if we do what I suggested, it's about $175,000 to the good. And then when we look at the general fund, the main budget, Fund 11, that's where all the fun begins. And I'll go over to the right-hand side of the first page first. On that first page of Fund 11, which is the revenue report, over on the right, I have a column that says cumulative deficit. So when we get to the end of reviewing this general fund budget, the general fund shows a deficit of $437,000. Then the highway fund has a surplus of $151,000, and the library has a surplus of $24,000. So the cumulative deficit, if all this comes to pass as laid out on all these papers here, at the end of the year is about $262,000. And at our estimated grant list for 2020, to retire that deficit before we spent one penny on programming in 2021, we'd have to raise the taxes by 3.4 cents to get rid of that deficit. Now, we can talk about the deficit in more detail in terms of how we handle a deficit in several months when we really know what our deficit might be. As I have mentioned before, I called Duxbury in the before town meeting. You know, you don't really have to raise your taxes by 50% all at once to retire a deficit. You have the ability to carry that deficit and retire it over a five-year period. And you don't have to do it all at once. But that's a discussion we'll have when we really know what the deficit is. What's driving a lot of the deficit right now here is right there on the first line. And the select board may not want to do what this says, and if you don't want to do it, I understand it. My philosophy here has been, there's a lot of people out there that are hurting, both in the business community and I think that people are going to have a difficult time paying their taxes. But knowing people as I know them, and especially elderly people who for some reason want to pay their taxes the day after they get the bill because they don't want to owe anybody if they happen to die, there's a lot of people that will pay their taxes just because they have a tax bill. So this budget right now assumes that instead of a 55-cent tax rate, the select board chooses to set a tax rate at 50 cents. So that's a 9% reduction over what the voters authorized us to raise. My guess is if you sent a tax bill that was a 55-cent tax bill on the grant list, it would generate for the general fund about that $1.8 million, and our delinquencies would probably not be $450,000 like this is showing right now. It would probably be a lot higher than that. I mean, a lot lower than that. Many more people would have paid their taxes than this is presuming. But I'm a little concerned that that if we end up, let's say we bill all of our taxes and then there's a fairly substantial amount of it that has gone unpaid, and we decide if the legislature gives us the authority to waive penalties and interest on it, then the only people who get the help are the people who don't pay. And if they don't pay, if they're not paying just because they're saying, well, I'm not going to charge interest and penalties, so I'll keep it in my pocket, if they really don't hurt at all, they're getting a benefit that maybe they don't need. This way, if we set a tax rate lower than we've been authorized, everybody gets a lower tax bill. It will really help those who need the help, but it will also not penalize people by having them kind of have to carry the burden of other people who don't pay just because they don't feel like it. So it's a philosophical discussion, but I wanted to start with that. So this proposal shows that we're going to bill $1,455,000 in taxes. That's the new target budget that's in bold. And then it also projects that regardless of what we bill, I think delinquencies will probably be higher this year than they have been in the past. I don't have the town report, but I think our delinquent rate right now is less than 1%, right? This assumes a 5% delinquency rate. So the 1.382 shown there in the projected column assumes that 95% of the $1,455,000 is paid. And the lost revenue is the lost revenue between what was budgeted at 1.832 and the 1.382 that I'm projecting as collected. So that's a big hit right there, $450,000. It's more than the cumulative deficit of the fund, if you look over at the right-hand column. The reason it's more is because there are other things that I'm assuming we're going to lose revenue on as well. So here, if you go down to the under other governments, I'm speculating that the state isn't going to pay us the full 208 for pilot, that we're going to get 156,000. It's an estimated guess. It really has no basis in anything. I just said that looks like a number that I'm thinking I'm going to put in the spreadsheet. The forest and parks in current use, those, again, both come from the state. There's a less likelihood that those will change dramatically, but I can see that they might say we're going to have a small reduction in those, so I reduce that a little bit. That's pretty much for the other governments. Duxbury did pay their first installment of the 2020 fire contract last week. We got a check for about $57,000, so they paid that. Under the service fees, Carla will have a better sense of this than I do. So far, through 29% of the year, we collected 31% of our town clerk's fees. So we were ahead of our budget pace through the first 3 months of the year. I assume that's dropping off considerably at this point. But
I don't see it dropping off.
Really?
A lot of recording, a lot of refinancing.
Okay. So maybe this.
And the realtors and lawyers are back with that.
Maybe this $21,000 reduction here is too much. But anyway, that's good to know. Historical Society is a little bit. When you look at the recreation income, this budget, the way I built it, I won't say it's a worst case scenario, but this assumes a situation that I didn't think that we would get in. So you see that there's a fairly significant cut in recreation revenue. Swimming pool revenue is down from 45,000 to 10. If you go into that projected column, I already, in the target column, it's down by 15,000. But what these target numbers, or the projected numbers, I'm sorry, the ones that are kind of highlighted in brown, what this is assuming is if you looked at the expense side of the recreation programs, you'll see that we don't have much savings there. So this budget is presuming that we're going to be told everybody can go back to work, everybody can go have life as normal, you can open your swimming pools, you can open your recreation program. I'm suggesting that once that is done, that we open up and we fill up. But a lot of people say, you know, we really don't have the money to pay the full boat. Can we take some reduction? Again, it's just purely speculative. I think there's a better chance that we can't run a program at all than I think that this scenario might come to pass. But I wanted to be pretty conservative about it. So I'm showing significant drops in revenue and not significant, not cuts in programming that are to the same degree. So if this is tipped against us the way that I budgeted this. And then down the bottom, everything else is pretty much the same. So we end up with, at the very bottom in red, $738,537 less in revenue than we budgeted if this all came true. And then from there, and I'm not going to go through every single page of the budget, but in all of these budgets, from the general fund right through, every budget has some reduction of spending in it. Some is more than others, maybe not enough, but in the end, if you go to the very last page of Fund 11, you'll see that spending is dropped by from the budget column to the projected actual column. Spending has dropped about $297,000. So revenue drop of $738,000 and $297,000 in spending cuts. And that generates the $437,000 deficit in the general fund. So I know that's a lot to digest. I'm just trying at this point in time. We're still, you know, barely 90 days into our fiscal year, and especially on the revenue side, we really don't have any clue until we get into August and September before we really know how things are going to sugar off. So I'm going to take a breath and let you ask questions, but that's what I've come up with. I think the biggest discussion we're going to have, and it does not have to be tonight, is what we're going to do with the taxes. Are we going to bill the taxes as authorized and just deal with delinquencies that are higher than normal, but not anywhere near as high as I'm projecting on this paper in terms of lost revenue? Or are we going to be proactive, like the water and sewer issues were with the base charges for water and sewer for the June billing? You know, they gave away between water and sewer about $200,000 of revenue to everybody, both businesses, unemployed people, and people who are still working. They did that to everybody just in order to allow people to keep some money in their pockets at this time. So I think that will be the biggest discussion, and we don't have to make that decision until the first week of July. We probably should talk about it again before then, but that's when we set the tax rate as the first meeting in July.
Hey, Bill, this is Mark. I have a question. Have you thought about trying to estimate that number, or is it a complete guess? Because my first thought would be to at least lower the penalty for a period of time at the current due date.
Yeah, so with regard to penalty and interest, we need a little help on that. The town meeting set the penalty and interest at town meeting. They voted to have an 8% penalty, and they voted to have interest that ultimately will be 1.5% a month or 18% a year. We don't have the authority to change that penalty unless one of two things happen. One, we can go back and have a town meeting, and this is a legal opinion that the cities and towns have received now. So we'd either have to go back and have a town meeting to waive the penalty interest, or the legislature has to pass a bill that allows the select board to do that on its own motion. There's a bill in the legislature now. I think that will probably happen. But again, under normal circumstances, we budget about $50,000 for penalty and interest every year, $22,000 for interest and $27,000 for penalty. I think that if we don't do anything with the tax rate and those penalties are not waived, the interest is not waived, we'll probably have higher posting of that. How long it takes to collect it is a different question. But, the sure way to allow people to have a savings is to actually set a lower tax rate. And I've tried to accommodate that by trying to make some pretty serious cuts in spending to offset a good amount of that reduction. You don't have to make that reduction. That will be completely up to the board at the time. But I felt like this was the best way to present it for right now, and there's plenty of time to mull it over.
There could be a hypothetical scenario here where we lower the tax rate to 50 cents and the penalties and interest are waived. As Bill had suggested earlier, older people are still going to, because of their nature and the way they were brought up, typically go out of their way and do whatever they have to do, make sure their taxes are paid. But then you may get a degree of other people to say, if there's no penalties and interest, I'm just going to hang on to my money. We could end up in a worse scenario here than what Bill has laid out for us. Let's hope that that's not the case, but you know, it's pure speculation at this point as to, you know, how many people are really going to be seriously financially injured on this coming out the other end. I know there's actually there are some people that employees that with filing for the unemployment benefits, if in fact it holds true that they continue to get the extra $600 a week
through the July.
Yeah, so they're $1,100 a week per.
Or if you're entitled to the maximum state benefit, which is $513, you know, so somebody who makes $850 a week, if they're fully unemployed, could be collected $1,100 a week.
Per spouse, and then there's a $500 per child.
No, that's not the unemployment benefit.
So
the unemployment benefit is for the
$600 on top of what you normally
on top of the whatever your normal benefit would be. The other the stimulus check, which is up to $150,000 household income with $500 per child. That has nothing to do with unemployment.
Is that a one shot deal?
So far, yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
right,
some people could, you know, just from the unemployment benefits alone could come out of this thing a little better than it went into it, you know? So it's a crapshoot at this point. I think Bill's done a great job speculating what he, you know, as good as anybody, what his guess is how this thing will sugar out.
Yeah, I mean, the savings that I'm showing there are savings that I think that we can realize through the layoffs and reductions of hours and some reductions of spending. There's probably more places that can be done, but I don't want to. If I find more savings right now, just like this, then it shrinks that cumulative deficit. I'd rather have the cumulative deficit estimate to be high, and when we get to the end, that it's actually lower than I'm planning for. I'd rather not say we're going to have a $200,000 deficit, and it turns out to be an $800,000.
On the paving portion of the CIP, that's another best guess. You don't know when those crews are going to be allowed to go back to work, what kind of summer will be left, and who's first on the list.
Yeah, so with regard to paving, Bill Woodruff and I talked about that last week. If you remember during budget time, I told the board that I think this was a year that we were going to put the paving out to bid. It's been a number of years since we've done that. We're hoping now that for the reasons you just talked about, we'd be better off trying to negotiate with, you know, just like we have in the recent past. Because if we put it out to bid and Pike gets it, we're just a little fish in the bottom of their fishbowl, basically, you know, in their aquarium. So I think we'll stick with trying to deal with local folks with regard to it. We might have to, you know, pay a little bit higher price than we would if we went out to bid, but I'd rather make sure we get it done as opposed to, you know, having it done in November or something like that.
As there is, there probably hasn't been any discussion with them at all.
Please talk to,
oh, yeah,
to John a little bit. I told him last week, I said, well, call him back again and, you know, keep the dialogue going.
Again, nobody knows what the cost of asphalt is going to be at this point. I mean, I don't know how many of you kind of watched what happened today, but oil prices were negative $35 a barrel at closing there around 2:30 there when I had stopped up to have a bite to eat. That's when they closed out the stock market for oil prices. It was negative $35 a barrel. So who knows where that'll all land it by the time this thing, the ball gets rolling on paving projects again. Anybody got any questions or comments?
Yes, I have three points, some are comments. First, I guess, comment is, Bill, I'm very sympathetic, and I think that's a good idea to drop the tax rate to 50 cents. There are a lot of people hurting in the Waterbury economy, and I think it's the way to give the entire community, aid, and I think it's something that's sustainable. The two other points that I want to bring up is, one, I guess I'm a little concerned about the rec department as well as the library department. I want to be as optimistic as I can, but I'm really questioning if we're going to have the ability to have, like, the pool open this coming year at all. And I don't know, maybe we should plan on that not happening. I know we don't want to think like that, but that's a social distancing nightmare if that pool's open. The other thing, a question or comment, I too, as you pointed out, I'm questioning what the library staff are doing. Is there some sort of accountability on what the folks are doing? I know they're the librarians are more focused on, digital, lending of materials, et cetera. They're purchasing digital materials and other materials. But I also question, I know everyone wants to be honest, but there are some people that may not be as forthright, what they are really doing for their time. And I don't know, maybe there has to be some sort of accountability on, in terms of what their hours are, what they have done with those hours.
Yeah, well, I'm attempting to get that, Mike. I've had conversations with the library director. I've had these conversations with the library commissioners. And, I get emails from all me, and it will tell me what these folks are doing with their time. I don't have the ability to monitor it myself. And I think I mentioned this to you at the last meeting, but I do not supervise any of the library staff.
Right.
The library commissioners supervise the library director directly. The town is involved because, we provide them the lion's share of their funding. I help them on their budgets, and they use our personnel policy. But I don't have the ability to direct anybody to be laid off in the library. I've made suggestions. I've kind of tried to point out what I just did here with you folks, that, look, if you just kind of whistle past the graveyard here because you don't think your budget is impacted, we're going to get to next year. And if you don't do some heavy lifting now in terms of planning for savings, you're going to be in a rude awakening next spring when it comes time to put the budget together, because we're not going to end up with a $700,000 or $800,000 deficit, and the library has a $25,000 surplus, and they just go on like nothing happened. So I'll continue to work with them. As I said, they have laid off two part-time people. That's gone on for about a month now. For the first one, and the second one is 2 weeks in. This budget that I showed you tonight, Mike, includes one of the employees who works 35 hours to have those hours cut significantly to about 7 or 8 a week. So that's pretty much, it's not quite a full layoff, but it's 85% of that employee's time. But the rest of them, the director and the children's librarian and the adult librarian and the tech librarian, right now, the director, who's a salaried employee, has taken a voluntary pay cut, and the other three hourly employees are giving up about 5% of their time. But, you know, it's an issue that I continue to raise with them, Mike, but I don't have the
ability. Right, and I understand that, and that's something you just have to deal with both the probably the director and the commissioners, because I know, you know, you don't directly, but ultimately they come to us for money, and yes, they have to be somewhat responsive to the needs of the community in this, you know, bad time.
Yeah, so you, I mean, they'll be in the January time frame to talk about their budgets with you, and we'll see where it goes. But I'll continue to work with the director to try to make inroads there and keep them moving towards some cuts. With regard to the recreation, I hear what you're saying. You know, there's for the. I don't want to make any decision that's too early without some more information from the governor's office, Mike.
Right. Understand.
I have already talked to Nick Nato, the rec director. He has talked to people who we have lined up to work as camp counselors and lifeguards, and they've all been told that we're in an unknown situation right now, that we cannot guarantee their jobs. We're a little bit fearful because obviously, you know, some of these kids are going to say, well, if I don't have a guaranteed job, I'm going to look for a different job. And
right.
If we do open, that could leave us a little bit behind the eight ball. But right now, you know, especially for the summer rec program, there's, you know, 85 to 100 families that kind of count on that. And we don't want to wait too long because they've got to make plans to do something different if we're not open. But on the other hand, they're all kind of scrambling to just teach their kids and keep their kids at home. And if you drop on them right now that, well, you're going to have your kid home all summer long too, there might be a little bit of gnashing of teeth out there. So I'd like to wait a little bit longer before we make that final decision.
No, I understand. You know, we don't want to see the suicide rate in Waterbury increase by having kids locked up in home all summer long. That is a sentence I don't think most parents want to see.
Yeah.
Just kind of a thought. It's, you know, I think it's good that they're starting to lean to open up some functions of society. Opening up the rec department, boy, that kind of, you know, unless we see a real, you know, some better testing or, you know, ways that we could test people and, you know, show, because with those rec departments, it's going to be very difficult to socially distance all the kids.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. If social distancing is a requirement at all, you know, packing 100 kids into that rec building is probably not going to happen. But
right.
I'm not quite ready to say that yet.
Same
they
with
really
the
have to pour the chlorine into the pool to sterilize all them kids.
Exactly.
Thanks,
Bill. Everybody else still with us there?
So I don't have anything else to present on this stuff. We do have a couple of other issues that we want to talk about. But any other questions on the budget stuff? Hey, Mark?
Yep.
I'm not sure I answered your question before. So you said something about could I estimate, you were talking about the taxes and the penalties and stuff, but I'm not exactly sure what you were asking me. I don't think I answered your question.
No, I think you did. I think it's going to be really hard to estimate how many people may be late on their payment. I do agree that I think this has to be a just not maybe at the levels that we currently are at, but I think I'm fine. Thank you.
Okay, good. Thanks.
So you want to talk about this certificate of compliance?
Yeah, this is just really a housekeeping issue. The state of Vermont, V-Trans, has standards for highways, bridges, and culverts. If you follow the standards, you are eligible for more grants. And it used to be that you could get a higher reimbursement rate for projects if you adopted the standards. I don't think they've done it yet, but they were moving towards saying if you don't adopt the standards, you don't get any money. We had adopted the standards in 2013. That's the last time that we have done that. The state sent an email to Bill Woodruff today and asked them if they would if we would update the standards to their 2019 template. I don't have it with me, but Bill told me that it's only slightly different than the 2013 template, and we're doing pretty much all of it anyway. So I think it's just kind of a form of work. I would recommend that sign the plan. And I don't think any of you have it out there. It just says we, the legislative body of Waterbury, certify you understand the standards for the town road and bridge standards and public works specification. We've reviewed the staff, and we're recommending that we do this at the state's request.
Want a motion for that? Anybody like to make a motion for that to adopt again the state standard for road and bridge for 2020?
So moved.
Let me second it, please.
I'll second.
Second.
All those in favor, say aye.
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 And what we're going to do with this, Chris is here tonight, he can sign this. We're going to have to scan it and send it to you and ask you all to sign it individually. We'll end up having the state of all 5 pages together. The state has told us that this time the select board has to sign it. Next time it comes up, they said that the select board could authorize the manager or the public works director to sign it, but they want all the select board members to sign it this time. So we'll send this out. If you can print it off and sign it and scan it and send it back, it would be helpful. If you can't, if you don't have the capability to print, let us know and we'll send it to you in the mail or something.
Anything else? You, Mike, you wanted to talk about the school board election there for a bit?
Yeah, just for a couple of minutes. I know there were two candidates that, and we wound up not making kind of a recommendation. And I know the one candidate that was not selected, I know he kind of, you know, had kind of a little bit of an issue with the other king, because I guess he didn't realize, you know, he sent his letter in, and I know he didn't appear at our meeting, although he didn't realize that when we were meeting, so, you know, otherwise he would have. I don't know. I guess he's disappointed in how the school board made that selection. I don't know, you know, there's nothing I'm sure we could do about it, but I don't know. What's everyone's thought about, you know, maybe in the future we need to consider, you know, possibly making a recommendation of a candidate that we think is best suited for Waterbury's needs. I don't know what anyone's thought.
I'll speak to that, Mike, in that I was in attendance in that meeting. This is Nat Fish. And I'm awfully glad that we didn't make a recommendation that night, in that I had not heard yet from Scott Culver.
Right.
And it was very clear to me after listening to both of them at length that Scott was the most qualified candidate for the job. My personal opinion, but I was completely shocked that he was not placed in that seat, because it seemed to be that he had pretty much everything that they were looking for. You know, so going forwards, I would say that if we're ever, you know, if we're ever in that position again, and we need to make a recommendation, we need to have 100% attendance, and we need to be able to ask our questions, and we need to be able to hear both sides. And so, you know, that's my stand.
Yeah, Nat, I agree with everything that you just said. And as a matter of fact, I spoke with Scott personally, and the reason I guess I'm a little bit taken back, because again, the information that the other candidate, you know, put forward, from what I understood, wasn't. What he put forward to us wasn't totally how he stood, and even with the questions that we did ask that night, I don't know if he wasn't not honest, but maybe we weren't asking the right question. But I know I did a little bit more research, and maybe we made a mistake, and that's all I want to say. And maybe it's sometimes, again, we need to look at, if we have a situation like that where they are looking for a recommendation, more fully vet and let candidates know, yes, we want your input. And, you know, maybe versus two paragraphs, you know, in an email, you know, give us some more information on how you stand.
Right.
Now, this is, so if this situation occurs again, and it's after July 1st of this year, the select board will make the appointment. So there was a little bit of discussion, evidently, after the school board meeting, and someone suggested to Scott that the school board followed the wrong process and that it should have been the select board that appointed this, filled this vacancy. It is a little bit odd that when you consider that the school board is representing, it's a unified union school board, and you have members of the school board from Bayston and Duxbury and Warren and the other five towns making a choice as to who would best serve Waterbury. So a question was put to me. I felt that I needed to get some legal advice, because clearly if the process was the wrong one, we should have known that and should have the ability to make the appointment. Long story short, the appointment process that ended up appointing Michael Frank was the proper process. The proper board did the work that was supposed to be done. There was communication with the select board. We, as the town, we didn't put it on our agenda, but there was communication from the school board to the select board about this process. The select board had a chance to be involved if it wanted to. We didn't put it on the warning. It was, I'm sure if maybe we were meeting in person, it maybe would have made it on there differently than it did. But, you know, Scott, his candidacy was, frankly, at the 11th hour. We didn't even know that he was going to be running until just, the, I think, the, maybe the weekend before our last meeting. But the long and short of it is the process for this time was followed correctly. There has been a change in the law now, however, and the law states that as of July 1st, 2020, when there is a vacancy on a school board that's a unified union district like ours is, that it is the select board of the town where the vacancy occurred that makes the appointment. So we won't have to worry about did we do this right or we should be more involved. If it happens again, they'll have to come before you as the select board to get appointed.
Thanks, Bill.
Katie, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, so weighing in on this subject, I was reached out to by Alex Thompson, who's another one of the Waterbury representatives for that board, and there had been talk from the Moortown and Faison residents on some social media sites that nobody had reached out to the Waterbury Select Board and nobody had talked to them about putting forward a person to nominate, and I said that that was incorrect, like that we had been reached out to and we decided not to make a recommendation so that, you know, people weren't confused or getting the wrong idea. Going forward, I think that we may talk about a process where if someone wants to join the school board, maybe, you know, interview them or like have them come into a meeting, make that a part of the repertoire. I don't know. But I also think it'd be another topic to bring up maybe on a future agenda. About having representatives come in and talk to the board at, you know, our select board meetings regularly to have input and regular conversations with them. I don't know if any of you go to the meetings or you watch them online at MRVTV afterwards, but I think that's really important that we all are on the same page. So we have the most representatives on the board. And so if two people come to, like, one of our meetings during the month and then the other two can come to the next meeting, I don't know. I just think that that could be something that we talk about for a future possibility.
Totally agree, Katie.
So I'll speak to this issue there just for a bit. One, I'm kind of shocked, Nat, that you're, you know, the fact that you seem totally convinced that Scott was the correct person for that seat, that Mike ended up with it. I was going to attend the meeting. I didn't for reasons I can't talk about here kind of personal reasons, nothing between Scott and I, but, so thinking about this whole thing, because Scott approached me about the fact that he felt that the board, overstepped their bounds. I asked Bill to look into it, and he did, and that's why he came up with the answer that he did. But moving forward, I'll just throw this out to you guys, and I don't know how this change would take place, if it'd be a legislative change, but to Bill's point about Scott stepping into this thing on the 11th hour, that, to me, was an issue. And moving forward, if perhaps the state legislative body had to weigh in on this, I'm wondering that in this particular case, we had two candidates originally that both ran during town meeting for one seat. Two candidates, yeah. So they both were on the ballot. Kelly Hackett and Michael Frank, and Kelly Hackett got the nomination or the position, and Mike came in, you know, a fairly close second, but not too close. So I'm wondering that moving forward, if the legislative body at the state level could change the rules on that. And by default, if somebody resigned, by default, that from any town, a representative resigned, by default, you would approach the second candidate, the one that didn't get the position, to see if they were still interested in being on the board, and by default, they would fill that position. And if they weren't interested, then you would have you know, some other people, as in this case Scott, could step forward and try for that position. But my reasoning for that is the town weighed in on both those candidates, and there was a fair amount of votes in favor of both of them, with only one winner. And with our situation, if it had been handed to us, there's five people, you know, obviously we're supposed to represent the town, but it's kind of a, to me, it's a kind of a lopsided way about putting somebody into that position under these circumstances. And I didn't know that if you had a default scenario in there first and then resort to the select board after that, if that in fact failed, if that failed, then it would come back to the select board. What do you think about that?
Chris, I totally disagree with your methodology, and I'll tell you why. Because say you have two people running. One receives 1,000 votes, the other receives 50 votes. The voters clearly didn't want the second place person. You know, there's not really a threshold that you're going to say what is an adequate second place. I think you can't just then give it to the second place person if they're still interested. I know if you run, but, you know, the voters have basically said that that person, they don't want that person. Granted, this is not the case. You may have had a closer election, but I don't think we want the legislature mandating second-place candidates automatically get the job. Just my
opinion. I hadn't thought about that, Mike, having such a disparity in the vote count, but that there is a point there.
Well, just to close the circle here, if this should happen again, the current law is that they would come to the select board. And just so everyone is on the same page, Michael Frank now will have to run in March for the unexpired term that has one more year left on it. So if Scott decides he wants the seat badly enough, the seat is going to be up for election next March. Appointments, whenever a vacancy is filled by an appointment, the appointment only lasts until the next election. And there was a lot of discussion about whether the next election could be as early as potentially June, because their budget failed. And if the school decides to have a budget vote in June, there was a lot of discussion about, is that the right election? And the lawyers all finally came down to agree that this position is a Waterbury elected position. It's not a school district elected position. This position was warned as part of the town of Waterbury's town meeting. So our next election isn't until next March. If the select board decided to have a special town meeting to ask voters if they wanted to waive the penalty and interest, the position would be up for election at that time. So
on that note, I did convey to Scott when he contacted me that perhaps at this time that he just maybe not muddy the waters and just continue to attend the board meetings and bring information to them as he see fit, and then moving forward when election time came around, wherever it may be, that he put his hat in the ring at that point. So it looks like the decision has been made, and if he's still interested, then he has that right to put his name on the ballot when the time comes. Okay?
Perfect.
All right. Well, if there's nothing else, we can close this thing out for tonight and let you people get off the phone. Motion to adjourn, yeah.
Seconded.
Okay. Thank you all very much.
Good night, all. Stay safe.
Yeah, take care.
Hey, hey, Bill, are you still there?
Yeah.
Quick question. So if Karen is already thinking about canceling Arts Fest for July, is that a strong yes that the parade is being exoed for this year?
The Rotary Club has already decided to cancel the NQID parade. They're planning on having the fireworks that night as normal, figuring that you can watch fireworks with social distancing, but it's hard to have a parade with social distancing. So the parade is off. The Rotary and RW are in discussions about some late summer joint event that they would do together, assuming that social distancing would be passed by then, but they have not, they're in just the conversation stages right now.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Okay.
All set?
Yep. Bye.